Hello, welcome to another episode of Better Pet Parenting. This week we're going to speak to Wagging Tails Foundation, and we're going to speak to Mansi, who's one of the four female founders who have kind of started this. I don't know why, but a lot of people actually we speak to on the women. I don't know if it's just the pet care space, which tends to be more female-dominated, or if I am just naturally reaching out to more women. Hi, Mansi, how are you?
Finally.
Yes. I was just talking about how I just realized that most of the lives that we've done have been with women.
Oh.
I don't know if this is like a pet care space thing, or if like just selection bias and it has happened. But interesting. Like-
It's a fun fact. Most of our donations come from women.
Whoa. Very interesting. Yeah. I think we should
have big hearts. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe that's what it is. I'm sure the guys on this chat will not agree. That's what we're going with. Awesome. So I was just introducing you and what we're going to talk about this week. The idea is to discuss all the myths that exist around adoption, right? And there are a bunch of them. And we've got a couple of questions as well. So it'll be interesting to talk about them and finally kind of settle them, right? But before we get into that, tell me a little bit about Wagging Tails, how you got started, who the other founders are, what do you guys really do?
Okay, so Wagging Tails is basically a women-led registered charity based in Delhi. And we provide medical assistance. We rescue dogs that need help, medical help. And apart from that, we feed about 400 plus dogs in South Delhi, Central Delhi every day. And we also sterilize and vaccinate community dogs. And we also help find homes for our Indian dogs, Indies, as we fashionably call them now. We registered the charity last year in October 2020. And one of the good things to come out of this pandemic was that it gave us the time and the headspace to actually kind of work towards this direction. So basically, we have four women that have, you know, we come from different spheres of life. And we, some of us had regular 9-to-6 office jobs. This lockdown actually helped us to kind of pause and reflect that, you know, let's just put our energies into something good. And obviously, like, there was a lot of time to work from home and, you know, the pandemic. So that's how WTF. But we were working in animal welfare in our individual capacities even before that. So, I'm just the part of that.
So, your voice is getting cut a little bit towards the end.
Is it better now?
Yes, better. I think maybe the distance helps. Yeah, basically, you started or you already had this idea and you kind of just like focused more during COVID, or what really happened?
So, like, my family is, they're like big time animal lovers, and I started with when we had our first pet. So we've been feeding for last 6-7 years. And, but we were like, because I had a job and like is enough, most people do.
Yeah.
After the lockdown, during the lockdown, the first lockdown, I also happened to adopt. And I think that really opened a lot of avenues for me, my perspective to look at things. And then I also happened to meet Malvika, who's one of the co-founders of Wagging Tails. We got talking. Like, you've been doing so much work, and I would see her struggling with finding.
Mansi, your voice is, sorry to interrupt again, but your voice is, I think, cracking. There are some people on the chat also are saying it. You have headphones or something?
Yeah, I do.
Go for it. Wear those.
Is it better?
Yeah, much better.
I feel like my dad right now.
wired headphones.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you met Malvika.
So I met Malvika. So there's Malvika and there's Malvika. So Malvika and I, we're mostly involved in most of the groundwork. And Malvika and Poonam, who's another co-founder, they mostly help us with donations, with fund appeals, and most administrative work. So when I got talking to her and I realized like how much work she's been doing for the last 5-6 years, and I was like, this really needs to go out to people, and especially when you're working on a scale, when you're actually helping out so many animals. So I think, you know, fundraising kind of becomes a very important part, and being on social media is one of, it's like the right thing to do nowadays. Whether we like it or not, it's one of the good things that come out of social media. So it helps you reach out to more people. So then we decided that, you know, if you're going to be doing it, let's do it right. Let's register it first, because I've seen a lot of people have been working for years and they don't register, you know, the charity. We wanted to keep things very transparent, and that's how we, you know, WTF came into the picture. Yeah.
Awesome. And I know you also mentioned that you have plans to also have some kind of facility, right, ultimately.
Sorry, I lost you.
I was saying that I remember when we were speaking, you also mentioned that in the future, maybe you want to have some kind of facility.
Yes. We've actually zeroed in on a place, and I think in the next 3 to 4 months, we're going to have a full medical recovery center. So, yeah.
Nice. That'll be really cool.
Yeah. So, we'll have live sessions from our center then.
Amazing. That'll be exciting.
Yeah.
Awesome. So then let's get into the topic now, right? You said you feed more than like 400 dogs across Delhi. And I'm sure from those dogs, there are a lot of these cases that you kind of have to attend to, right? Medical or otherwise. How do you usually facilitate the adoption process? Is it usually the people, the dogs that you're feeding people? The dogs that you're feeding kind of are then adopted, or how does that work?
No, so see, so the approach has kind of changed over the months. I would say, like, initially, when we are not really into adoptions, we would think like it's a very easy thing. But trust me, it's the most, when people ask me, you know, what's the most difficult part of your job, I think adoptions are one of the most trickiest and most difficult part of my job, because I have to deal with people, and people are complex, and so are their issues. So, yeah. So I think it's very, very difficult to find the right home sometimes, you know, for a dog. And I would rather prefer them to be on the streets wherein they're getting proper food, where they're getting, you know, proper medical attention, and we can take care of them there, than to be in a home that does not really want them. So that approach has kind of changed over the last few months. Through because of our experiences and whatever we'd like to call them. So so normally we only put those dogs up for adoptions wherein, you know, they can't go back to they can't go back to the streets. Basically, it could be because of the fact that, you know, they had some medical issue. We got it treated, and it's a good way to, you know, if you can, they can find a home. A nice loving home. So that is kind of how we decide.
Understood.
Normally we don't want to put any random puppy up for adoption. That's not how we work.
Got it. Right. Yeah. And I understand that it also probably happens, I mean, why you put certain dogs up for adoption then is also because they've been separated from their pack.
Right? Yeah.
So
yeah.
Then it's kind of feasible to have them maybe stay at home.
Yeah, like is one that- of our puppies. One of our puppies, Pablo, who's up for adoption recently, so he's the only survivor of his entire litter. So and, you know, so it just made sense that, you know, if you can find a home for him, it's better. And plus the place where he lives, it's very, the streets are really bad, and you know, one thing could lead to another. So yeah, we decided that
understood. Yeah, so makes sense. So basically it's usually dogs who are kind of have already recovered from whatever medical illness they were suffering from, and now you're just looking for a home for them, right?
Yeah.
Awesome. So I think that's like a perfect segue into the myths that we wanted to bust. What I've kind of done is I've added those as questions so that everybody who is watching can also just read what topic we're on, right? But go for it. So myth number one.
Okay, myth number one would be a myth about adoption in general, I would say.
Yeah.
So a lot of times people think that adoption is a very time consuming process, which I will partially agree. It does take time. But if you're comparing it to just going and buying from a breeder, which, you know, I've had people who have inquired about a puppy and then they just say like, oh my God, it's taking a lot of time. Let me just go and buy from a breeder. Like, don't bother. So for those people, I have to say, like, if you know, filling up a form is tiring for you, if, you know, a house check is inconvenient or it's cumbersome for you, I think you need to really reassess your whole situation of getting a dog or a puppy home, because it's multifold the work, you know. So if you're not ready for this, if you're not ready for this, how are you going to deal with that?
So, filling a form is going to be the least of your worries, guys, once you get a dog home.
Yeah, exactly. And like, the last thing you'd want is like, you know, like a pup is sent to a wrong family or you know, that's not what they want. And so it takes time. So normally, even when I get adoption queries, I like people to sleep over it, and you know, I normally respond to them the next day, because sometimes you just see a pup and you're like, this was what was missing in my life and I need it right now, and then next morning you're like, oh my God, no. so that, I think it's better, like, it should be a well thought decision, and it's going to change the life of an dog is actually going to be with you for the next 10-15 years or maybe more. So it has to be for good.
Yeah. Got it. So you're saying basically that the time that should actually go into the process is warranted, because it forces you to kind of think about what you're doing.
Yeah.
And plus, go in for the right decision. Yeah.
Right. And most rescuers and, you know, even adoption coordinators, they have their protocols. There's a process that you need to follow when you want to adopt a dog. So I think it's for a reason, and people don't want to understand that.
Okay, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, okay. So another myth that is usually thrown at us is that, you know, there's something physically wrong with adopted dogs, or, you know, dogs that have been put up for adoption. There's some emotional problem, or there's some physical problem, or basically they're damaged goods. So which is not correct. Here again, I'm really sorry, but I have to bring this breeder and debate, you know, wherein I don't think, you know, when people go to a breeder, they don't not even know what is the medical history of the puppy. They do not know if the mother was ever vaccinated, if the pup has been vaccinated, how old is he. A lot of times breeder just lie about the age of a puppy. And I've seen, you know, cases wherein a ill puppy was sold to them and he dies within another, say, maybe a week or two. So I think in this case, at least if you do your research right, if you speak to rescuers, you'd can get a very clear idea of what you're getting into. They'd give you an entire, you know, they could give you information about what is the medical history of the dog that you want to adopt, and what is the vaccination schedule, if they've been vaccinated, not vaccinated, a lot of things basically.
So basically you're saying that if somebody does choose to adopt, rescuers are actually a lot more particular about whether vaccinations have been done, what illnesses they kind of came from, and you'll actually get maybe a lot more information on that than you ever will with, say, a breeder.
Yeah, like buying from breeder is like I, one thing I really don't understand is what is with people saying ki mera wala breeder acha hai. This I've heard from so many people when I'm trying to counsel them, like please don't buy from breeder, that, you know, nee, mera wala breeder bahut acha hai. So I fail to understand, like, what do they mean by that? Maybe you bought that puppy for 35,000 instead of 20,000, but that does not guarantee that, you know, that breeder has some different techniques or whatever. So I think people just don't want to look past that. They have a quality standard in their mind, you know, that, okay, it's expensive, it's going to be good.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
So the price kind of acts like a proxy for a lot of other checks that you should be doing.
Yeah, right. So another thing that I feel is that adopted dogs, this is specifically for indies, I feel that people think they're very difficult to train. because I've seen, so see, training as it is, you guys know, is a fairly new concept to a lot of pet parents.
Yeah.
Because like even like 5 years back, it did not even occur to a lot of people ki acha matlab dogs ko train bhi kara sakte hain, or you know, there's a certain behavior they're expected of, or matlab if there are any discrepancies, how to correct them or anything like that.
Yeah.
So people, I think you guys did a recent poll also wherein you asked people like why you know they're not quite okay with training, and most people said that it's an expensive method.
Yeah.
And I think it's true, but you can also train a puppy or a dog by yourself, but obviously you have to devote time to it. So it's and plus every dog has a different specific, you know, a different training need.
Mm.
So it is less to do with a breed. And I think indie dogs are perfectly trainable. They're very smart. They're very intelligent. They're very intuitive. So I think that bias comes from people's laziness rather than the breed itself. So that is a very big assumption. Like I recently spoke to one of my, I sent my dog for to a dog trainer some months ago. And I asked her how many indie dogs does she get on an average. And she told me for every, say maybe if she's training 10 dogs, at least 2 to 3 of them are indie dogs. So I think that's a welcome change.
Yeah.
So I'm glad that people are taking that step. And yeah.
Yeah. No, I think, I mean, I can vouch for that because our dog is also adopted. She's an indie.
Yeah.
And I mean, she's as easy or difficult to train as any other dog would probably be.
Yeah.
I think you're absolutely right, right? While knowing exactly what your dog, you know, what the genetics are and all can definitely help. But beyond a point, every dog has a unique personality, right? So you really need to work on figuring out what they need.
Yeah.
And
so,
giving
like,
that to them consistently.
So I'll give you a small example. Like my neighbor's dog, it's a Labrador. He's adorable, but that dog does not know boundaries. And I love dogs, but I know he does not know boundaries. And I think that could have been easily fixed if it was trained. And to them, I think it never occurs that, you know, we should train our dog and all. But because it's a breed dog, he can get away with that. But maybe if my dog, who is an indie, would be doing that, people are going to frown that, you know, oh my God.
I think social media is to blame. All those videos of just ridiculous puppies.
I would agree.
I think we need more content for indies. I think that's something that should come out of
I have to give it to people. Like, you know, there is a lot of awareness than what it was some years back. And I think young people are really stepping up their game. And I think it's become a cool thing also now. No one wants to be seen as that, you know, animal hater and crew. I would not want to be friends with such people, honestly.
Yeah.
So I think that's changing, which is good.
Yeah.
So another thing that I often get from a lot of people is that adopted dogs are not very well socialized. And also, you know, they're difficult to coexist with other pets. So, which again, I think is a very training specific issue. Not even training specific. It's mostly to do with the way you raise your pet. Because I've seen dogs that are perfectly compatible, and you know, they're happy coexisting with cats or other birds, or like I've seen that. And I think it's a lot to do with the, you know, the owner, because these traits, it's like parenting. Like, you know, if they're slowly able to train them or induce these things into their daily lifestyle, I think so I think the dog is not to be blamed here.
No, I think makes sense as well, right? Mm-hmm. Because, again, really, I think depends on a case-to-case basis, right? You will have breed dogs also that may not really coexist with other pets. At the same time, if you've got, say, an indie dog who you adopted, and you kind of raised them through the socialization period, then you can really actually have a dog that really gets along with other animals. But I'm sure there would also be cases, right? Of course, you can't, I mean, there aren't going to be absolutely perfect adoption cases as well. There will be dogs that have some kind of history, of course. Right? And maybe those aren't for everybody. But it's not to say that it's a blanket kind of generalization that this is how all, you know, Indies turn out to be. Makes sense.
Yeah.
Got it. So now we're on to myth number 5.
Yeah, so myth number 5 is basically for people who think that, you know, adopted dogs, again, indie dogs, I'd like to say specifically, are kind of inferior to breed dogs. So I think for these people who have these kind of notions, I'd just like to say that I think either they need a fresh pair of eyes or they need to get their eyesight checked, because I think indie dogs, the kind of variety in terms of looks, in terms of size, in terms of temperament you'd see with indie dogs, I think it's just vast. And I think they're beautiful. Like, a lot of people would agree with, you know, like dogs in general are great. Like, I love dogs, but like, every household has the same Labrador. Like, if you're looking for, like, I'm really sorry, I love dogs.
Feel bad,
but
for all the labs I know.
Like, if you want to stand out of a crowd or like whatever it is, like, you can, I think it's an unfair judgment when people say that indie dogs are not good looking. I think indie dogs are great looking, and they're super smart and they're super intelligent, and I think they're very well suited for our weather, you know. They're the most practical choice. I don't know why people still want to pay money to buy dogs, but yeah.
No, I think makes a lot of sense. They're actually literally Darwinian examples of what has evolved to become the best breed for our country. So I think that, goes without saying. I'm surprised actually that people don't realize this almost instantly. But cool. So let's get to some of the questions, right? Rio wrote in the chat, can first-time dog parents adopt an older dog instead of a puppy? And would it be advisable for someone with no prior experience? What is your take?
I think it's absolutely fine. See, a lot of times people think because they're getting a puppy home, so you know, it's going to be a learning phase for you, which in a way is right. But people don't see the fact that a puppy is a lot of work in terms of, you know, training. You know, the amount of pee poop training, leash training. You have to socialize them. Okay, and there's going to be a chewing phase, a biting phase, the lot of things to deal with. So I think an older dog is a good option, but you need to be well versed with the reality, like how you're going to do it, what is the amount of time that you're going to denote. But I think it's something very doable. It's not bad.
In fact, I know a couple of my friends who, first time that they wanted to get dogs home, and so far, you know, they haven't been able to because usual reasons, right? Parents are not okay wiping after the dog, and kind of the assumption is that when a puppy comes into the house, they will wreak havoc, which can really happen as well. But you know, these friends then basically got older dogs home. In fact, my partner as well, his first dog, not his first dog, his second dog was actually already 1 year old when he came home, and immediately you know, like, he just took to the house and people got along. I mean, it just kind of became very easy to deal with it because you actually skip the problematic part of raising a dog as well, right? So I think it could definitely be something that you can try out. Like, get help if you need it, right? If there is something that you're not sure of, if there's something that you're not sure that you want to kind of how to tackle certain situations, obviously get the help that you could that could help you along the way.
You know, plus I also feel that people don't realize, like, people, dogs also have personalities. So as a puppy, it's very difficult to say that, okay, this one's going to be this way, or this dog is going to be this way, this puppy is going to turn out like that. So it's very difficult. Like, you have to give. So that's why we always encourage people to, you know, adopt slightly older dogs, because then you know what you're getting into.
Correct.
You know, if your lifestyle is something that you want more, you know, you want a slightly fuss-free dog who's okay staying independent, or, you know, who's not very, who does not need a lot of attention. So I think it's a more practical choice for people.
No, I think makes, I mean,
Yeah.
a lot of sense. Okay, cool. So this is something that I think we've covered a little bit, but Gaurav has a question. Do rescue dogs have more behavioral issues considering their stressful past?
I do not think so. Not all rescue dogs have behavioral issues, but for example, like not every dog has anxiety issues, but at the same time, a lot of dogs do have that. But there's nothing that cannot be. So see, just like a learning phase, there's an unlearning phase in a dog's life. Okay, especially when they've been in an abusive household or in a household where they're neglected or something bad happened. So it takes time for them to decompress and actually gain back their trust and personality. So for a pet parent or someone who is willing to adopt such a dog, the only question is, are you willing to put in that time? So like nothing that cannot be dealt with, but it's just about, are you willing to do it?
Makes sense. There's another question from Akila, the Indian pariah. What should be kept in mind if you plan to adopt an adult rescue dog, as they would be used to street life?
Okay, I've seen a lot of people who have gone to adopt dogs that have lived most of the life on the streets, and I think it is that transition has to happen slowly. You just can't expect that the dog is suddenly going to be comfortable coming into your house, because it's just going to be a very alien concept to them. And at the end of the day, the last thing you want to do is make them uncomfortable, or because it's just, that's not how it's going to work. So I think you can slowly try to bring little changes, introduce them into the house, and then let them decide. And I've seen like where people have been more patient with the transition, they've taken each day as it comes. It has worked really well. Yeah.
No,
So I
I
think it
can
has to be.
test. I think makes a lot of sense, and I can testify to that because, in fact, one of the dogs I have at my parents' house is a street dog who kind of just one day walked into the house. And slowly over, like, it took at least 2 years for him to fully trust us and actually, then stay inside the house majorly. The first year it was just that he used to come inside to sleep, get his meals, and then he used to be out. Then second year he started like sleeping inside. Then he had a routine where at 3 in the night he would want to go out, and then he would come back and whine near my parents' window that, okay, I'm back, let me in. And they all adjusted to this, right? My dad used to actually go and open the door, which never would have happened for the kids, but happened for the dog. But yeah, I think it just takes a little bit of time, right? Because they're also, I think, trying to adjust to this new life with just humans around and no dogs, and there are different rules. But yeah, I mean, you definitely need a lot of patience, and empathy to kind of do it. Awesome. There's a couple of more questions. I have a rescued 1-year-old Indy, been with us since he was 40 days old. He's normally very calm around his friends and family members, but he barks a lot whenever he sees a new big dog. What can be the reason for that? Never had any bad experience with a dog.
I think that's quite normal. Like, see, like, I think a big dog, it's very obvious that he might feel threatened. Like, anyone who would see a dog like who's bigger than him, I think it's a very obvious reflex that he barks. Like, a lot of dogs do that. So I don't see it as as something wrong or something which is not correct. I think it's quite okay for him to bark. It's just dogs have their ways of
Communicating.
communicating. So it's, I think it's just a reflex.
Sudha, if you need more help, you can DM me and I can kind of help you through this also. But yeah, I mean, essentially what we're trying to say here is that you can't really just like club indies into one bucket, right? Maybe you can kind of do that with breed dogs to an extent, where you can say generally Labradors have a certain temperament or generally retrievers have a certain temperament. But I think by default, indies are such a mixed bag, right? Literally, they've got so many genes, they've got so many different experiences that they've kind of gone through over years and years and years of procreation on the streets, that you really can't just say that indie dogs are a certain way, right? And that's, I think, part of the experience as well, right? It's kind of a little bit like a mystery box where they will delight you in some way or the other if you look out for those delights and surprises.
Right.
Tell me how you got your dog. Like, how was that process for you?
So basically my mother, I remember my house was being renovated and we had just come back from Burma and so we were living with my parents' house because my house was being renovated. So they already have two pugs, okay? So, sorry, cough, breeder, cough, wrong decision, okay? So, so they're pretty old, so that's the only way I can justify that. So then, so basically, during that time, during the lockdown, we were, so me and my husband, we were living, we had a lot of time and we decided, okay, we'll be moving into a new house. So it's a good time to, and we were very clear that we want to adopt. So we adopted through a rescuer, modern Mowgli. And I remember the mother had just birthed some 5-6 puppies and we, you know, fell in love with Bali the moment we saw him. So we didn't know he was a guy until then. And even if he was a girl, so we were anyways going to adopt him because so I'm from Uttarakhand and I just love hairy and I've always been
dogs.
And I've just been crazy about black dogs. Like my sister tells me, like, even when I'm out feeding, the energy that I have with black dogs is something else in me. Like all my favorite dogs are black dogs. So so I always knew that, you know, I'm gonna get him home. And then it's been more than a year and I think it's worked superbly. And normally when we take him out for walks and people ask us, oh, what breed is he? Is he a, what, I don't know, like, what's some weird breed? And we're like, no, I'm sorry, he's an indie. He's 100% pure indie. So then,
you know what you should do? You know what you should do with every new adoption you put up? You should just invent a new breed.
Yeah, I think that's...
I think all the... exotic enough for people to want to adopt.
Yeah, I think people need new breed names. Seriously. Yeah, but it's been a very wholesome experience.
I'm sure. I mean, I've been obviously following your page and seeing all the content you guys put up. You're also doing like a brilliant job just telling the stories, right? Because it's, I think that makes a lot of difference also now, because the moment you see, like, you know, a dog and pictured in such a amazing way in terms of how he's kind of behaving and what the story is like. I think that angle of humanizing these dogs also is maybe helping adoptions, right? And why maybe you, like you said, right, they're on the rise.
I'll give you a small example, okay? Like there's this, I don't know if you've seen that reel of a dancing dog. We call her Shakira, okay? And she lives near your C block in CP. And... I don't know, one day I just randomly noticed the way she dances and, you know, I just captured it and we made a reel out of it and people just went bonkers and and my sister was like, where is this dog? And by the way, she comes with me to feed. And I was like, that's that dog. Do you know that's the dog? And she's like, oh my God, I never noticed she dances like that and all.
Yeah.
And I was, and even like people ask me, where is this dog? And I can tell them 100%, even if they, you know, go there, they'll not be figured out that she's the same dog because she's a completely different personality the moment food is not there. So, yeah. So, it's just, they're weird. Dogs are weird.
Yeah, and I feel like the more you start looking at dogs and start understanding how they kind of talk and communicate, the more you start understanding their personalities also, right? Otherwise, it's just like, this is what dogs are like. But then you start understanding, okay, this is what Shakira is like.
Yeah.
And this is what Bali is like. And they're all just, like, so diverse. Yeah. Which is amazing. But thank you so much for doing this, Mansi. This was great. I had a really fun time. And hopefully, people will kind of watch this and want to adopt more.
Yeah, I hope so too. And thank you so much for having me. It was great talking to you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.